Hello, everyone. It's Professor Buzzkill, your favorite internet history professor. You know, not very often a book comes along that has all kinds of great stuff in it, not only intellectual stuff and important historical stuff, important cultural stuff, but sometimes juicy World War II stuff and juicy Cold War stuff. And a great new book entitled Codename Puritan, Norman Holmes Pearson at the Nexus of Poetry, Espionage, and American Power has just been written and just been out and is out today. Today's the mid-release date, by Professor Greg Barnheisel, who's on the line all the way from Pittsburgh in the Pennsylvania. Dr. Barnheisel, thanks so much for coming on the show.
Thank you so much, Professor Buzzkill. It is such a pleasure to be back on your show.
We should remind Buzzkillers that Professor Barnheisel was here on the show back when the Buzzkill Bunker was in Pittsburgh. Now it's out on the West Coast in California trying to learn how to surf, talking about his first book on literature and the Cold War and things like that. So we'll put a link to that on the blog post for this episode. I find this book so fascinating for 1,000 reasons. First of all, it taught me a lot about, I don't know any other way to say it, the changes in what is known as, or what is understood as Puritanism over the American centuries, but also all kinds of things about professors being involved in the war, professors being involved in the Cold War, professors being involved in the building of the CIA. It's just fascinating. I just wonder, it could only have been better if he had been a pirate as well as a side gig, something like that.
He may not have been a pirate, but he was a pornography collector, so he had a little bit of a spicy side to him as well. He was a kind of obsessive collector of many things, including pornography.
Well, there you go. We're PG, but we won't put that on the Buzzkill bookshelf. Well, first of all, start us off by telling everyone who Norman Holmes Pearson was.
He's best known as a Yale professor, and he taught American literature at Yale for about 40 years. He was at Yale. He went to college there, and then he went to graduate school there, and then he taught there until his death in 1975. He looked a lot like a Yale professor. He was this tweedy, small man who always wore a nice, well-cut three-piece suit, and he taught Nathaniel Hawthorne, and he taught other courses in American literature. But what makes him interesting to me, and I hope to many other people, was that when the Second World War started, he was recruited into the OSS, which your readers may or may not know was the Civilian Intelligence Service that eventually morphed into the CIA. And he was brought into the OSS and became a very high-ranking spy. And we'll talk about that, I assume, later on in the program. But he became a very high-ranking spy there. And so after the war, what makes it particularly interesting is he, as you had pointed out, he becomes one of the few men who makes the actual connections between elite academia and the national security state that is emerging. He definitely worked for the CIA on a kind of freelance basis for a few years, but even after he was actively with the CIA, he also worked for American cultural diplomacy, even at the same time that he's teaching literature. So I find him really interesting because of the way that he embodies something about the American 50s, which is many of our elite and powerful institutions, the military, academia, the business community, government, and also foundations, they were kind of working in concert with each other to pursue American Cold War goals. And certainly throughout the 50s and 60s, they really had the confidence of the American people in a way that kind of fell apart because of the Vietnam War. But I call this a kind of new cultural consensus. And I think Pearson was really one of the architects of that. And he's very little known. So I was really gratified to be able to tell his story.
Well, he's little known outside Yale and maybe even outside the libraries at Yale because he donated a billion types of literary collections to Yale. That was a fascinating thing I read in the book. But can we start with Puritan and Puritanism? Was he himself raised as a Puritan, or did he come from Puritan stock or something like that?
Yes. And so this is one of the ways in which, and we'll talk about this later in his academic work, but he brought American Puritanism back into the center of the way we think about what this country is about. And when we think of Puritanism, right, we think of censorious people. We think of like people who are trying to shame you, people who don't talk about sex, people who are religious fanatics. We often think about the Pilgrims, who weren't exactly Puritans, but it was similar enough. And Pearson did. He came from Puritan stock. His family, the Pearson side of his family, came to Massachusetts. They immigrated from Yorkshire to Massachusetts in the 1640s. And they lived there, and they were prominent business people, and they worked in government as well. They were in the, I guess we would call it the Governor General's office for the Massachusetts Bay Colony. And so they really were those people who we think of when we think of Puritans living in these small agricultural communities, these English settlers. And this is one of the things that drew Pearson to the literature of Nathaniel Hawthorne, who tended to write about the Puritans. And so Pearson really liked Hawthorne because he felt he was writing about his ancestors. So Pearson has a personal connection with them. And he is linked to them not just through the Pearson line, but also the Holmes line. And if you're familiar with Oliver Wendell Holmes, he's related to that family. He's related to the Kittredge family, who is another important Puritan name. So these are all of these old families based in eastern Massachusetts who were really some of the earliest builders of the New England portion of this country. And for various reasons, including the popularity of writers like Nathaniel Hawthorne, including the dominance of the publishing industry that was based in Boston, even as America grew, even as the United States grew and grew quite diverse, not just in terms of ethnicities, but in terms of where people were living. The story of America in the 19th century really was the story of the Puritans and the New England settlers. And so Pearson grew up at a time where he was told that your ancestors are the truest of all true Americans. The Puritan settlers, those are the most American of all Americans. And so Pearson grew up thinking that. And so he grew very curious about who his ancestors were and what they meant.
I find it one of the things interesting about that, because that sort of group of Puritans and really the group of New Englanders is very tight-knit. And Pearson, throughout his entire career, has offered all kinds of jobs in different places and doesn't take them, sometimes because he'd rather stay at Yale. But you mentioned a few times in the book that he just doesn't seem to want to leave that community.
No, he wasn't an agoraphobe. He loved traveling, and he traveled all over the United States, and he traveled all over the world. But New England was his home, and he used to joke about the fact that when he grew up in a town called Gardner, Massachusetts, which is about an hour west of Boston, near the New Hampshire border. So it's very, very New England up there. And when he moved down to New Haven, Connecticut, which is also, part of New England, he joked that he had gone west because it was about 20 miles west. So that was him becoming a Westerner. So yes, he was always very comfortable there. And he didn't really stray very far from there. Although, as you say, he was offered many job opportunities, including one really attractive job opportunity after the war at the Huntington Library in Sedona, which would be hard to turn down. Anyone who's been to the Huntington Library, that's about the prettiest place you could imagine.
Yeah, it certainly is. Well, then tell us about him growing up and going to college. We need to, first of all, probably tell Buzzkillers that he suffered from a number of health problems and a physical, what in many parts of the book, when you're quoting original sources, is referred to as a deformity, what we would now call a disability, of course.
Yes. So when he was very small, his parents owned and ran the major department store in Gardner, Massachusetts, which is a small New England city. And like many small New England cities at the time, it was an industrial city. It made chairs. They ran the department store. So they were an affluent family. They were one of the leading citizens. And one day when he was about 7 years old, he was playing with a friend of his and he fell off a barn roof. He broke his pelvis and he broke his femur. And it was a compound fracture. So the bone came through the skin. And this would have been in about, 1915, 1916, something like that. And the hospitals weren't particularly good. They didn't have antibiotics back then. And so the bone was set poorly. And he was, as you say, many people called him deformed or crippled, but his leg wouldn't work right. It jutted out at a strange angle. And he developed something which I had never heard of before writing this book, which was he had tuberculosis of the hip. So the tuberculosis bacteria.
I didn't know what that was.
I didn't either, but the tuberculosis bacteria can colonize bones as well.
Okay.
So he had tuberculosis of the hip from the time he was about 7 years old, and it didn't clear up until after World War II. So this was a...
Yeah, you said that until they injected him with new penicillin after World War II, it didn't heal up.
Yeah, exactly. And so he would spend, his time as a kid on crutches, and he had, I don't want me to be gross, but an open seeping wound at all times, and occasionally it would flare up. So and he was, visibly disabled, and he could not take part in sports because his leg wouldn't work right. And then he was skinny. He was always fighting off infections, and because they didn't have antibiotics, he often would get these very life-threatening infections when he was younger. He had a lot of physical hardship, even though economically and socially, his family were in quite good shape.
But then he goes off to Yale for college.
He does. He goes to Yale for college, and he's expected that he's going to go into the family business, and he is going to run the department store. But his family has some concerns about this because of his physical health. But while he's at Yale, it turns out that he's really smart. And a couple of his professors spot him as somebody who could actually go into academia. And Pearson also gets really excited when he's working on a senior project about Nathaniel Hawthorne. So when he's a senior, he writes his mom a letter, and he's like, "Mom, I know that I said I was going to go into the family business, but I just really want to be a professor. And so I'd like to do this." He manages to land himself a fellowship at Oxford. Now, this wasn't a Rhodes Scholarship or anything, but it did pay for 2 years at Oxford. So he went over there, and he didn't have to pay for it. So it was on the fellowship's dime, and studied. And as you know, better than anyone else, Professor Buzzkill, at Oxford, you work individually with tutors, professors, and, mm-hmm. and his tutor, oddly enough, was C.S. Lewis, who would later go on to write the Narnia series. Was before C.S. Yeah. Lewis had written any of these books, and C.S. Lewis was a crotchety, stuffy Brit who absolutely detested Americans and hated any modern literature. So Pearson had a real tough time with him.
Now, ordinarily, I'd say, okay, now he's sort of on an academic trajectory. He's going to finish up at Yale. He'll probably go on for a doctorate or something like that, even though doctorates weren't as necessary back in those days as they are now to become a professor. But then the war intervenes. And it's surprising to me that this person, granted, he goes into intelligence, but still having this disability, it's sort of surprising to me that he snapped up by the OSS when there are other, in theory, hale and hearty people they could have chosen. Were they going for his brain?
Yeah, so that was very interesting because, as you say, he's doing his ordinary graduate student stuff throughout the 30s, and he's trying to write his dissertation, and he is, and we may talk about this later, but he was a kind of obsessive networker and collector of people and contacts. So he spends a lot of his time in the 30s meeting everybody in the literature field and all these famous writers as a way of making connections for his future career. So the war breaks out, and he, as you say, he was disabled. He was not eligible to serve in the armed services. And he figured that he was going to spend the war teaching freshman comp to the various people who also couldn't serve, who were going to Yale. And Yale itself had turned into kind of a military outpost. It became the barracks for the Army Air Corps. And he figured he was going to do that. And he was disappointed because he was really pro-American. He had become very, very pro-British during the 1930s at a time, which, as I'm sure you've talked about in previous shows, at a time when there was a very strong strain of isolationism in the country and a great deal of sympathy for the Germans. And if you have had previous conversations here on your show about the America First movement, it actually started at Yale University.
Yeah, that's always been amazing.
The America First movement started at Yale University, and Pearson was watching that. And Pearson, by that time, was very pro-British, and he was outspoken against that and wanted the U.S. to get into the conflict earlier. So he was disappointed he couldn't serve. And he mucked about for Yale for a couple of years and didn't know what he was going to do and felt sorry for himself. But then he got a call, and they said, "We'd like to see you in Washington. I think we may have a job for you." So he goes down to Washington, and they want him to serve in the research and analysis branch of the OSS, which is exactly what it sounds like. It's a bunch of tweety, smart, educated people reading intercepts of communications and filing them. And it's boring work. It's sitting in a chair. And in fact, they jokingly called, there was a lot of Ivy League professors. There were a lot of like heavy brain power in this. They called it the chairborne division, which I always find that amusing.
Right. Not airborne.
so yeah, he's there. He's doing his thing. He's not really liking it, but he's doing his part to serve the country. And then somebody comes up to him and says, "You know, I think that you have some talents. Even though you're a cripple," which is the term that they use, we think you've got some talents. And they tag him and three or four other men to form the counterintelligence branch of the OSS. OSS was the civilian intelligence service. So its job was to analyze information and try to figure out who's a spy and what's the United States Army supposed to do when we go over there. But at the time, and I'm sure you've talked about this at some point in one of your shows, the Brits had intercepted the German Enigma codes. And so the Brits knew everything the Germans were saying and were intercepting all of their communications. And the Germans didn't know that they were doing that. The Brits did not want the Americans to have this information because they thought the Americans would shoot their mouths off and let the Germans know that the codes had been broken. So the British would not share this information. The high-ranking people at the OSS, and it was run by a man named General Wild Bill Donovan, Donovan knew the British had something, and he knew they wouldn't share it. So he gets in a negotiations with the high-ranking British intelligence officers, and he says, we know you have something, and we really want to be able to share it so we can contribute to this war effort. And they say, the only way we will do this is if you create a special dedicated branch of the civilian intelligence service, not the military intelligence service, and only they can look at this stuff. So that's when they created, the OSS created a branch called, it eventually was called X2, and this was the counterintelligence and counterespionage branch of the OSS. Pearson and three other men are flown over in April of 1943 to England to figure out how to set this thing up. They set it up. They're living in this strange little village and eating Brussels sprouts and enjoying playing. He's trying to learn how to play cricket. And ironically, it's the village where the playwright George Bernard Shaw is living in his in his dotage. So they're always trying to catch glimpses of George Bernard Shaw. So they do end up setting up the OSS as a X2 counterintelligence service. It moves to London in July of 1943. And Pearson is put in charge of it. So we have this little disabled Tweedy Hawthorne scholar now in charge of seeing all of the Enigma decrypts that the British Army is guarding so jealously because they don't want us clumsy Americans to spill the beans about it. And Pearson is the only one trusted with this information.
Now, is this where he starts to, can't remember exactly, but develop or maybe invent his index card system, his note card system that he used for both information and then used for people, which was then cross-indexed 50 million ways from Sunday and became this sort of, I don't know, mother load of information that the Allies fell in love with, the Allied intelligence fell in love with.
It was. The British had an astounding database, and we would call it today a database, but right then it was literally a card file of note cards. They had a database on quite literally millions of people, and they would cross-index their contacts with each other and all that, and was the envy of everybody. And so the Americans, with the Research and Intelligence Service that Pearson had served with back in Washington, D.C., was trying to develop its own American version of this. Pearson learns from that, and then he goes over to England, and then he's working with the masters of this, who actually have put this architecture together. And he says, I really have to learn how to do this. So yes, that's exactly when he institutes a British-style, we would call it today almost a big data approach to counterespionage, collect every last possible piece of data and information and cross-reference everything. And by doing that, patterns will show up that we can see. And ultimately, the goal of counterintelligence and the goal of counterespionage is to figure out who in our territory is spying for the enemy and how and what do we do with them.
And mainly what, and in his case, in the case of his media colleagues, how do we turn them?
Yes.
How do we get them to be double agents? That was, you know, you read this part of the book and, you know, the heartbeat quickens. It's just fascinating thinking that this guy, you know, who's been in a sort of kind of enclosed world in Yale all this time, is now going to be thinking about how to go out and find German spies and turn them.
Yeah. And this was a innovation of the Brits. Once they had these Enigma decrypts, they identified every German spy in Allied territory. And as I say in the book, and as I'll remind people here, in 1942, Allied territory was basically Great Britain.
Yeah,
the entirety of Europe was either Nazi occupied or neutral. So Allied territory was the British Isles.
And even Spain, which is technically neutral, is fascist. So, yeah.
And they knew every German agent who was operating in that territory. And so the question was, what do we do with them? And the traditional answer to that, of course, is you find them and kill them.
Right.
But the British intelligence service were experimenting with this new technique of flipping them, turning them into unwilling double agents. And so Pearson got deeply involved in that. And so, yes, he's finding these German agents in Britain. And then eventually, because he's not really in charge of what's happening in Britain, in the territories that the United States Army has liberated from Nazi occupation, it's Pearson's job to identify German spies, German stay-behinds in that territory and figure out what to do with them and how to turn them.
Yeah, but you know, seeing him in his young life, you could very quickly establish a stereotype of what could be his trajectory. He's disabled. He's an Ivy Leaguer. He's probably going to be a loner, probably going to be just a bookworm, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Yet, in London and then elsewhere, he uses these personal connections that he's made to constantly I don't know, I don't want to say socialized because it's not necessarily the right word, but some of it is socializing with all the right people in order to get to all the right people.
Exactly. You know what
I mean? He's incredibly outgoing in that regard. It's just amazing.
And that's one of the things that I tried to do in this biography is give the reader a bit of a sense of what kind of a person he was, because he was, as you very accurately point out, he was a socializer, and he socialized because he liked it, but he also socialized instrumentally. Like, he wanted to get things out of it. And my hypothesis is that this was part of the product of being a young boy who was sickly, who couldn't take part in sports, who was smart, who wanted to socialize. And so he develops this kind of adult maturity and ability to, and I don't mean manipulate people, but engage with people in a way that makes them want to be around him. Mm-hmm. And he learns that from a very young age. And so reading his correspondence, and one of the nice things about writing this biography was that Pearson was an obsessive collector and kept everything. And so his archive, which is held at the Beinecke Library at Yale, has everything, including get well cards from his third grade class, which is sort of fun that, you know, a third grade class back in 1918 or whenever it was wrote get well cards to their classmates, just as I did back in the 70s. So some things don't change.
But sometimes there's too much material and you think, oh, no, I don't have to go through another box of his mother's discarded recipes.
Oh, yes. I have many experiences of that. But yes. And so through, and as I said earlier, he does this when he's a child, to kind of substitute for all the stuff he can't do as a teenager. He does it when he becomes a graduate student as a way to get a leg up in the profession. He makes a point of making friends with important writers and also important fellow academics who are going to be helpful in his career. And then, as you say, during the war, he used it as a way to ingratiate himself with the British intelligence services. He was very clever because he, as I said, he'd done a couple of years at Oxford. And so, and he was a very smart person. And so he knew what British intelligence agents liked. And British intelligence agents tended to come from the upper crust. They tended to be aristocrats, and they tended to disdain Americans. And so Pearson knew how to suck up to them in a way that didn't seem obsequious, but he never seemed like he didn't know his place. And because of that, he was able to achieve things for the American intelligence service and get himself embedded with the British intelligence service in the way that a more all-American sort of type might not have been able to. The one person who saw right through that, who knew what Pearson's game was and didn't like it, was Kim Philby, the famous British intelligence agent who was working for the Soviets at the time, because Kim Philby was equally good at that. And a game recognizes game, as they say.
Well, Pearson was Oxford and Philby was Cambridge, so there's that too.
And Pearson was middle class.
But also, you know, when he goes into the occupied territories, he is, you know, he's, and this is amazing to, this will be amazing to listeners, especially when they read the book. Remember, this is a man who has a non-functioning hip, a really badly healed broken femur. He doesn't walk very well, but he is literally parachuted in.
Yes.
I almost dropped the book when I read those.
To make this clear and vivid to your listeners, eventually to ameliorate the problems he was having with his hip, the doctors literally fused the top of the femur to the pelvis. So if you're sitting here and you're trying to lift your leg up, right, from the pelvis, he couldn't do that. It didn't move.
Yeah.
So he is parachuted in the day after Norway is liberated. He's parachuted in there. He's parachuted into Denmark because he was always jealous of the people who were working for him who got to go work in the field. And he always wanted to do that. And so eventually he was able to do it. And yes, he was a very physically courageous person and very physically, especially for a man with a very significant disability, he was very physically active. He loved hiking to the degree he could do that. He loved camping. He ended up making several trips, very sort of roughing it trips to places like Greenland and northern Quebec and the Arctic. He was very physically vital, and that was important to him.
And by the way, while he's in occupied territory, or I should say while he's in liberated territory, he uses a lot of these same skills. I mean, he's not able to haul his cabinets and cabinets of index cards with him, but he's able to use the social skills and other skills to try to turn people and get people on the Allied side as well.
Yeah. One of my favorite stories comes from before the liberation, where soon after he was setting up the office in London, they said, we need to have a branch office in Madrid, right? because as you'd said before, Madrid was technically neutral, but it was run by fascists. Franco was a fascist, and it was, not, if not formally allied with the Nazis, it was definitely sympathetic and leaned towards the Nazis. But it was a place, Madrid was a place that was a kind of marketplace of secrets. And so a lot of spies from all of the nations operated there to try to get information from each other. And so there's a funny story that Pearson liked to tell. Soon after, he was sent there to open the OSS's Iberian office in Madrid. He was checked into, and I forget the name of the hotel, it was one of the nice hotels in Madrid at the time, one of the better hotels in Madrid. And as a joke, the hotel keeper, put him in a room that was directly across from the room in which the head of Nazi counterintelligence was staying. And the two, they couldn't do anything to each other. They were on neutral territory. They weren't going to do that. And Pearson just said, hello, Herr, whoever it was. And he would say, you know, guten Tag, Herr Pearson. And his daughters asked him, he came home. So then at one point he goes home for a little bit of R&R, and he's talking with his stepdaughters and telling this story. And they were like, Pop, why didn't you kill him? Why didn't you shoot him? And he's like, we knew him. He's a man we could work with. If I killed him, they'd probably bring in someone even worse. So we knew what he was doing because we intercepted all of his communications. I knew everything about him.
Yeah, exactly. Better to let him, well, in that case, better live and let live. But then after the war, after he's back, you know, you think, okay, he might want to just say, okay, because he is so committed to literature, so committed to Hawthorne and everything else. Great. I get to go back to Yale. I can resume my studies and then become a professor, yada, yada, yada. But there are all these competing, well, if not demands, certainly requests for him to do all this stuff on the side.
Yes. And he really did want to go back and be an academic. He was, as I've said before, he really did feel that he had even more than most Americans, he had a special obligation to serve the country because of coming from this New England Puritan heritage. And they felt this extraordinary sense of civic responsibility. But he also wanted to be a professor. So he comes back and he's like, oh, I'm so excited. I can go back to my career. But they dismantle the OSS in 1946 and they wind it down. But very quickly, the United States starts realizing it's in a Cold War and needs civilian intelligence service. There is some hostility to that, again, from isolationists, particularly Republicans in Congress, who feel that it's going to be a kind of big brother situation. That's anachronistic. There was 1984 hadn't been written yet, but you get the idea.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But they end up in 1947 setting up the Central Intelligence Agency as a civilian intelligence agent. And they asked Pearson to be the director of counterintelligence, and he turned him down. He wanted to be at Yale. He wanted to live this life that he had dreamt up for himself. But he kept his hand in. And this is one of the interesting things about him, because when he came back to Yale, he had taught there for a number of years before, and he was a very popular professor. He was a very theatrical person, and his disability had given him a kind of sympathy and empathy that I think a lot of the very stodgy professors at Yale lacked. And so a lot of the young men at Yale, and again, as your listeners probably know, Yale was all male until 1971, I believe it was. So these young men really liked Pearson, especially if they were kind of like troubled or wandering. He was a compassionate and sympathetic person. So he gets a reputation. He's already kind of known, but he gets a reputation as somebody, they know he'd been in the spy services, but he couldn't talk about it. So he was the very mysterious, crippled professor who had some sort of spy thing about him, but nobody knew what it was. And so he was very notorious, and he loved that. He just enjoyed that people were always gossiping about him. But in reality, he was working for the CIA. He wasn't going on missions for them, but he was their primary recruiter at Yale University. And for your readers that know something about the early history of the CIA, its staff was populated, not exclusively, but heavily by young Ivy League men. Very, very much had a reputation as a bunch of intellectuals from the Ivy League. And oddly enough, for those of us who grew up in the Cold War, like you and me, it had a reputation of being full of lefties.
That's right.
But yeah. Pinkos, the CIA was full of pinkos, which was amusing to those of us who grew up in the Reagan era. But Pearson was the primary recruiter at Yale for the CIA. And he would spot promising young men who he thought could do it. And there was a dead drop mailbox in Washington, and he would send a letter there, and they would get this person's name, and then the CIA contact would get in touch with that person. And many of them ended up serving, including, and some of your writers may be familiar with the famed travel writer, Peter Matheson, who was also one of the founders of the Paris Review. He was one of the people that Pearson brought into the CIA.
Well, now the other thing he does is help create, or at very minimum, one of the founders of something called what becomes officially American Studies. As I was reading about how that was developed, I came up to chapter 11. And Buzzkillers, this is an Indiana Jones moment for someone like me and someone like Dr. Barnheisel. I'm going to start the story off and you're going to finish it, okay? Professor Barnheisel, as he's looking through the archives, runs across some copies of some midterm exams of Pearson's from 1950, 1951. And one of the questions is, describe and compare the final dinner parties of The Age of Innocence and The Lost Lady, two important novels, in terms of the symbolic value of each to the novel in which it appears. So these things are in his collection. And like you said, he saved everything. So he saved all his old exam originals. But then there's something on the back. That's just fascinating.
So this was my favorite find in his archive, because as you would imagine, with a man who's a pack rat and who taught at Yale for 35 to 40 years, there's a lot of old exams and a lot of old teaching files. And I got an office full of teaching files, and his teaching files are much more voluminous than mine. But because I'm a good and dutiful researcher, I look through everything. And as I'm looking through this and I flip over this one exam, this midterm exam that was on Edith Wharton novels, I see on the back this memo, and it's written to somebody named Mr. Jackson. And it's a memo about if one wanted to recruit into the intelligence services, here's what one might do. And it's all in the conditional tense. It's all this, the plausible deniability of like, if perhaps one wanted to recruit a bunch of Yale men into CIA, here's the kind of things we would look for. And here's how we would go about it so that nobody would know what we were doing. Again, entirely theoretical. Right, but of course, right. He was doing precisely that at the time. And then, as far as I understand, this memo was circulated among several of his colleagues from the OSS, who were also had studied with him as graduate students at Yale, had ended up being professors at other universities, places, you know, like Lee and Wesleyan and all that. And this memo gets circulated to them. And you can almost imagine with a sort of like nudge, nudge, if you might want to do this, here's how you might go about it.
But as you say also in the book, he was very careful about technically keeping it all quiet. And there aren't a lot of personal papers or diaries where he says, well, gee, this is, you know, I'm helping start up the CIA counterintelligence, so this is what I'm doing. This is what I did today. So it's kind of funny that these midterm exams with the spy stuff on the back, I presume that was handwritten, right, on the back?
No, it was typed. It was typed.
Oh, wow. So, but you would think, if I'm going to throw some old midterm exams away, those should be the ones I should throw away because they've got actual secrets on them.
So he died in 1975.
Yeah.
Height of the Cold War. Nothing's been declassified yet. And donated all of his papers to the Beinecke Library at Yale. For those of your listeners who don't know, the Beinecke Library at Yale is really one of the great rare book and archive libraries in the world, in fact. And I don't know if we'll get it. Chance to talk about this later, but Pearson, you did mention earlier his book collections, which he donated, ended up becoming the core of some of their most important collections. So he donated all of his stuff to Yale, and certainly the CIA scrubbed it. Certainly the CIA went through everything, and he was a smart person. He would not have kept anything in his possession that would have been in any way compromising. And so when you're reading, just to step back a little bit, during the war, his correspondence, of course, is censored, but he was cagey enough that he knew what he couldn't put into his letters home, and you know, can never identify what he's doing or names of people or places that he's going, and perhaps it comes out later. So, I mean, he knows better than to put this kind of stuff down in writing. And then whatever he might have had and might have kept when CIA, because when the collection was donated to Yale, CIA had scrubbed it because they didn't want any of this stuff to get out. So the only thing that I can imagine is that he wanted people to see that. I don't think this was inadvertent. I think this was I want to make sure you know what I did, sort of breadcrumb.
Right.
There's no way somebody that careful and that meticulous, leaves that document in there, not wanting people to see it.
Well, as I say, it must have been an Indiana Jones moment for you. So I was very, very, very jealous. But let's round up the show by talking then about how he helps develop this field of American studies.
American studies, and maybe some of your listeners took classes in American studies or perhaps had a major in American mm-hmm. studies, but American studies was an academic field that came about, it really was born in the 1930s. For people who wanted to think about the American experience, that the United States had a civilization that was worth thinking and talking about as a civilization separate from Britain or Europe. And it wasn't just the junior member of the Western Nations Club. And so there was a lot of self-justification of like, here's why we have a culture that's worth studying. And so in the 1930s and 1940s, that's really what people who were involved in American studies were doing. And Pearson was one of the first people in the country to receive a PhD in American studies. At Yale, it was called at that time History, Art, and Literature. It was not called American Studies. We'd only receive that name later. But he was one of the first people in the world to receive a PhD in this, which was tough for him because there were no jobs in it. So that's what his advisor said when he said, I want to get my PhD in this. And his advisor said, you got two strikes against you, love. There's no jobs in this. And you are, and this was the term he used, defective. And they were referring to his disability.
Yeah, physically, yeah. It's amazing the words that were used.
But then after the war, American studies stops becoming a kind of like justification of like, here's why we're a country that's worthy studying. And it becomes more of a, here's a way we could train Americans in thinking about this nation and what our mission is in the world, especially in a Cold War context. So American studies, particularly at Yale University, becomes very much allied with the United States Cold War, the Cold War project of confronting the Soviets, of defending freedom, free enterprise, all of these terms that I try to unpack a little bit in the book. And there's a number of schools that have American studies and American civilization programs at this time, Minnesota and Penn and Harvard, places like that. But Yale gets a ton of money from a very conservative businessman named William Robertson Coe, who says, I'm going to give you this very large bequest with $500,000, that's talking real money in 1947. And I want this program not just to be a bunch of eggheads studying America, but for training people to advocate for the values of freedom and free enterprise in a Cold War context. And so Yale says, thank you, Mr. Coe. Thank you for that donation. We're on it.
Now, how closely do they stick to that? Because you talk as these chapters go on, you talk about, you know, of course, the original one of the original definitions of culture, Matthew Arnold's, the best of the things that have been thought and said and painted and everything else, and then going on to Franz Boas and the cultural anthropology and things like that. How did Yale deal with things like that donation and not wanting to be dictated to by a rich donator? Now, granted, a lot of these people believe a lot of these concepts already, but they don't want to turn into Hillsdale College.
No, and that was exactly the tightrope that they had to walk. Because as you say, most of them agreed with it. There's a stereotype that maybe has some truth to it, that today academia is populated by a bunch of like screaming lefty commies.
Yeah,
I wouldn't say it's that there's no truth to that. But it sure wasn't true in the 50s. And particularly at a place like Yale, these were conservative Republican men all entirely.
They believed
these things, so they didn't have to be convinced. What they didn't like, as you said, is being dictated to by some Yahoo millionaire at the time. So they really did have to walk this tightrope of, yes, we all agree on these fundamental principles, but we're only going to do up to this point. And we are going to train people and lead them to the conclusion that free enterprise is good and collectivism is terrible. But we're not going to actually make them say that. And then the donor, Co, would often say, well, then you can't have all the money. And just as a side note, when Yale refused to give him right of approval over faculty hiring and firing, Yale would not do that. He said, okay, I'm taking up my money and I'm going elsewhere. And he ended up giving even more money to the University of Wyoming, where he did found the American Studies program there and did maintain that authority.
Yeah, and it's amazing that there's this stream of sort of accepted realities that capitalism is a good thing, American capitalism is a good thing, or at least the best of all the available things, and that American culture is a good thing. And then even people within Yale were complaining that they weren't doing it enough or weren't doing it well enough. So William F. Buckley then turns on Yale in God and Men at Yale and starts complaining. I think, well, you know, that's the wrong place to turn.
Yeah, he specifically names the American Studies program. Yeah,
that's weird.
As something that doesn't deliver on what it promised to do.
And it's, well, anyway, it's just weird. There are a thousand things wrong with that book. We should do a show just on that. And it was very, very baleful in its influence on American history.
Well, and just as a side note, Pearson, who knew everybody, of course, had a brief run-in with Buckley while Buckley was an undergraduate at Yale. And Buckley, he was the editor of the Yale Daily News, which is a very important big man on campus kind of position, and wrote an editorial, Buckley did, criticizing Lafayette College, because Lafayette College in Pennsylvania would not accept a donation from someone who says, I want this money to go to scholarships, but not to Negroes or Jews. And Lafayette College said, okay, we don't want your money. And Buckley says, well, Yale should jump on that. And Pearson writes a letter to the editor of Yale Daily News saying, like, this is a terrible opinion. This is absolutely not what a Yale person should think. And so they get in a little contretemps about that. But that was really their only direct run-in. Buckley ends up writing Buckley was a sort of a graphomaniac, and he wrote a ton of stuff. And he wrote a novel called Spy Time. Some of your readers may know his novel, Spy Time, in which Norman Holmes Pearson is a character.
Well, then how, if we take this trajectory of American studies being built up at Yale and at other places, but Yale's sort of the most important, or the summit of the mountain, however you want to describe it, and Pearson has a great deal of influence in how it's constructed, how does the Puritanism fit in? And maybe how have ideas about what Puritanism is changed by that stage?
Before I answer that, which is a really good question to conclude on, but before I answer that, I just want to point out to your listeners that American Studies isn't, in the 50s, just something that American students take.
No, that's
Pearson
right.
Ends up exporting it. So one of his jobs in the 1960s, he gets hired by the Department of State to go abroad and help foreign universities, particularly in Japan and Taiwan and South Korea and Australia, set up American studies programs.
Yeah, there's even a picture of him at one of these Japanese universities.
Yeah, as a way, to train foreign students who are curious about American culture and about American civilization. But as we know, the American studies pedagogy at this point was all about how American values were really the values that the world should be following. So Pearson is deeply involved in that. But to return to the Puritan idea, as I mentioned, as we started out with, the stereotypical view of Puritans is very negative. We think of them as just these kind of like prudish, killjoy religious fanatics.
Scolds.
And that was very much the opinion of the general public and even of intellectuals and historians well into the early part of the 20th century. And Pearson's favorite writer, Nathaniel Hawthorne, had a lot to do with that. They don't come across so great in the Scarlet Letter, let's just say. They seem pretty hypocritical in their morality. But Pearson tries to rewrite the story of the Puritans and explain that, yes, they were all of this, but what they were is actually sort of searchingly self-critical. And they're what we think of as this really simplistic, condemnatory Calvinist theology is actually an incredibly intricate intellectual system that we may not like the conclusions that it comes to, but it has to be respected for its architectonics, Pearson believes. Pearson is not a Puritan. He's definitely not a Puritan, and not really even a believer, but he respects them greatly in a way that most historians and intellectuals didn't. And so he tries to bring them back in as a kind of positive force, as people who were, we almost might think of them in his view, almost as New Age spiritual seekers. Like they were really searching for the divine. They were searching for what was pure and true in the world. And they did it through this Calvinist theology, which was very unforgiving. And it led them through its relentless logic to these conclusions that we really don't like, such as predestination and all of that. But Pearson says, you know, you got to respect that they meant it and they walked the walk. Now, I will say that Pearson was, of the many things he did and was well-respected for, he was never a hugely influential or well-respected scholar or theoretician. And so a lot of the American studies scholars and historians who knew a lot more about it sort of dismissed Pearson's ideas. The scholars who were much more serious and were professional scholars of the Puritans kind of dismissed Pearson as someone who didn't know what he was talking about. But Pearson had a power that he was one of the leaders of the American studies field. And so even though he wasn't as influential as a scholar, because as a teacher and an administrator, as someone who was setting policy for academic fields, he could get his ideas in there just as well as the other people could.
Yes, and you call that in the book, you say he's an institutional man in the time of institutional men.
Yes. And one of the books that people often think really embodies the 1950s is a book called The Organization Man. And The Organization Man is that basically makes the argument that in the 1950s, Americans had lost their individuality, their individualism, and their individual drive. And we all just wanted to be part of the big collective, which was business,
right?
You think about Mad Men, right?
Yeah.
That's what the Organization Man is criticizing. Yeah. Everybody just wants to be part of the big, you know, the man in the gray flannel suit. And Pearson, he was never that. He was never an organization man, but he was a man who believed in the value and the importance of institutions in creating America, and that we had to believe in these institutions, whether they be Yale University, the United States government, the United States military, the business community, the congregational church, whatever it was, that we had to subsume our individualism to these institutions, because ultimately they were working for the better, in the best interest of all of us. This is really one of my theses in the book, is this was a widespread belief and ethos of the American 1950s and 1960s until, and I think it's cliche to say that Vietnam did this, but when Vietnam was such a disaster and all of these institutions had told us that this was the right thing to do, and they were so deeply wrong that we lost our faith in these institutions and we became and we see this sort of the cynicism and disillusionment of the 1960s and the 1970s.
Well, that's a great way to wrap up the show. And Buzzkillers, please trust me on this. There is so much more in the book than we've talked about. The war stuff is not only interesting, the Cold War stuff is interesting, but also his influence as mentoring of a great number of American literary figures is so, so important. So please go to ProfessorBuzzkill.com, do everything you need to do there. Get the book. It's on the Buzzkill bookshelf ready for you to snag. And it is out today. Today is the release day. And so I just want to say thank you, Professor, for coming on the show.
Thank you, Professor Buzzkill. It was an enormous pleasure, as always.
Buzzkill is out there. We will talk to all of you next week.